Let's install TensorFlow 2.0 for Windows using the CPU. If you're interested in installing this for the Macintosh or for Windows with a GPU, that's a different video. I have links below. Hi, this is Jeff Heaton. Welcome to Applications of Deep Neural Networks with Washington University. To see all my videos about Kaggle, neural networks, and other AI topics, click the subscribe button and the bell next to it and select all to be notified of every new video. We are starting with a fresh install of Windows 10. This makes sure that everything works and is not dependent on anything that I might have done previously. I have all the Windows updates installed as of late December 2019. Now, each semester that I teach this course, I go through Windows installs with my students. There's usually over 80 of them. And believe me, I know most things that can go wrong with installing TensorFlow for Keras in Windows. I will try to point these out as I go through, but feel free to step past some of my descriptions of the errors. I have a link to all the parts of this video in the description so you can easily jump to the timestamps for each of these. Now, I do monitor the comments on this video closely, so if you run into any things, feel free to post them there. Also, search Google, because believe me, there's all kinds of information on Stack Overflow about the kinds of errors that you probably run into doing this sort of thing. The entire installation process for Windows takes about 30 minutes for me to complete. You can see this by looking at the clock below. I'm starting at about 7:15. To keep the video short, I will fast forward through the points where the computer makes me wait for things. You can see all the steps listed here. I also have a about the environmental script setup. There's a script that I provide to you, and I describe just kind of how that captures some of the installation processes. I will update this script as the semester goes forward, as TensorFlow makes changes that require some changes to this process. I'll only re-record the video if the process has changed substantially to the point that I can no longer just change the install script. This installs both TensorFlow for the command line and also for Jupyter Notebooks. At this point, you're ready to hook it up to an IDE if you choose to do one of those. I do have a separate video for PyCharm. Step one, we're going to download Minikonda, use Chrome or whatever your favorite browser happens to be. So go ahead and search for the Minikonda installation for Python. Minikonda is just the minimal version of the Anaconda Python environment, and all of these basically have the mathematical and artificial intelligence packages that you typically need already installed. You still have to install TensorFlow on top of it, though. It's critical that you choose a 64-bit version of Python. 32 bits is just not supported with TensorFlow. Also, use whatever the latest version. You see 3.7 here. If the latest version becomes 3.8 or later, install that. We're going to later create a virtual environment that has whatever version of Python TensorFlow is currently needing. Step two, let's install Minikonda. Okay, run the executable that you downloaded. Click Next to get onto the license agreement. Also accept the license agreement. Install it for just me. This tends to get you fewer security prompts later. This is the path that I really do prefer. Sometimes it'll try to put it under app data. This is controversial, but I do like to check both of these. If you're going to set it as the default one on the bottom one, you might as well put it as the top as well. This will just cause fewer things to not find it if you don't click that first check. Now install it. We're fast forwarding through this part because this does take a while. Minikonda is installed. Most of the time, things do not go wrong at this point. Now we're going to download an Anaconda YAML script that I created to do most of the installation for you. Just do a search on GitHub Jeff Heaton. That'll take you to my GitHub repository. You can see it here. It's a very cool repository, so definitely follow me. Click to star me. Go to this repository though. This has the file that you want. And scroll down and find tensorflow.yml. This is the script that you'll actually make use of. So click the TensorFlow YAML file to open it. And then click on raw so that you see it just as pure text. Now right click and save this to a directory on your machine where you can easily find it later. Here I'm just storing it right to my user directory. Okay, now it's saved. We'll use this in the next step. Before we continue, let's have a look at this file and see what's all packed into here. Now this may look different because I will update this. This is the name of the virtual environment that you're creating. So this can be a completely different version of Python and everything under your main install. These are the dependencies. This is what you're actually installing into there. Notice I am putting in Python 3.7. If later versions of TensorFlow support newer versions, and they don't always do that right up front, I will update that. I'll move that to 3.8 as soon as I'm able to. These are the other packages, and if they're version dependent, I will put a double equals on there, or single equals actually in this case, and lock them to something. There's also pip installs. The ones at the top are conda installs, and pip installs are just two different ways of installing things. Okay, step four, now we're gonna install Jupyter. You need to launch this. Now, I hate the ads in here. Some people say that guy looks like me. I really don't see it. But let's go ahead and start up a terminal prompt, command prompt, as they're called in Windows. The first thing we're going to do is rename that TensorFlow YAML file. Windows downloaded that as a text file, a YAML text file. I really hate that feature of Windows. We just need to rename it so that it's not a text file. It won't work. Now it's a YAML file, so we can now make use of it. And now we're going to conda install Jupyter. Jupyter is a nice sort of browser-based IDE that lets you mix a variety of things. We're fast-forwarding this part of it because it does take a while to install Jupyter. We'll use Jupyter for the initial tests. Even if you plan to use mostly an IDE, I recommend having Jupyter up and ready to go. Okay, Jupyter is done. So now we are going to run that installation script that we downloaded, the YAML file. Now make sure that it's .yml. If Windows appended a .txt onto the end, then rename it like we did earlier. Now I am going to run the command that creates the environment. This creates a sub-environment underneath our main one. I like to do everything in sub-environments and leave my main environment very clean. Now Windows violates this, unfortunately. You can't in Windows create a pure separate environment like you can in Linux and Mac. And there's some ramifications to this, and we're going to talk about this. This is one of the common things that will go wrong. So now we are in the process of creating this environment. This will take a little while. Now also, that command that I executed, don't try to type that from what I typed up there. I will put a copy of that in the description below of this video. That way, in case it changes any, I can make minor tweaks there. All right, now we can do a quick test. If anything went wrong there, then definitely Google your error message or post a comment. Now I can start up Python. You'll see that I'm in Python. I'm going to import TensorFlow as TF. Now this is not going to work. See, there's no module named TensorFlow. I'm still out in my main Python environment. I need to quit out of here and do conda activate TensorFlow. This moves me into that environment that I'm in. If you're trying to import TensorFlow and it's just saying that it's not there, you're usually not in the environment that you created for it, or you somehow did not install TensorFlow. Now I am in the correct environment. You are able to see from the prompt I'm in TensorFlow, and I import TensorFlow as TF. This takes a moment, but the fact that it's pausing is good. That means it worked. Okay, now I'm going to print out the version of it just to double check it. Print tf.version. Now you might have gotten some errors there instead. Definitely Google those or post them in the comments. Probably Google them first. And now let me show you some of the other things that can go wrong when you try it. This is a very important step. Make sure you complete it. That long command that I'm typing there is in the description of this video, so just copy and paste it from there. This registers that environment that you just created into Jupyter so that Jupyter can find your new kernel. If you skip this step, Jupyter won't see your kernel and nothing will work inside of Jupyter. Okay, now everything is installed. Step 8, let's test Jupyter and talk about some of the things that can go wrong. So make sure that you're in that TensorFlow environment, if not, conda activate it, and we're going to start up Jupyter Notebook. If you run this for the first time, it'll ask you what browser you want. I'm going to use Chrome. I hate that Microsoft keeps adding on Edges and Corners and Internet Explorers and other browsers that I don't want to use, but pick Chrome. Okay, this is Jupyter. We're going to go up to this new and create one. Notice Python 3 and 3.7 TensorFlow. If you don't see that 3.7 TensorFlow or whatever you named it, then you probably skipped the kernel install step that I told you about, and you'll always see it up there. You can also change kernel here at runtime. That doesn't work as nice as it should on Windows, and we'll see that in a moment. But let's go ahead and import TensorFlow as TF. That will show you that it's there, and we can print out the version. Let's go ahead and run that. It takes a moment. That shows that it's working. 2.0, perfect. If you're seeing that, you're basically done. But you may want to listen to this next gotcha in Windows. So let me exit that. I'm going to exit the command prompt and now start up like it's done. I've had many students do this where it worked fine when they were standing in front of me and then they go home and try it and it doesn't work. So let's launch a command prompt and let's forget to kinda activate TensorFlow. We're just going straight into Jupyter Notebook. We start it up and now we're going to create a new notebook. Actually, let's open up the old one that we had before. Now this notebook is already pointing to the correct kernel. It's pointing to TensorFlow Python 3.7. And if we were on a Mac or a Unix machine, this would work just fine. But in Windows, you have to specify the kernel both in Jupyter and at the command prompt before you start it. Otherwise, you will get errors. Now here, we're seeing that TensorFlow is not there. That's because we have the wrong kernel. It didn't save our kernel from before, so we select our kernel. On the other operating systems, you'd be fine. You would have still gotten that error on the other OSs. But in Windows, you run this and you get this dreaded DLL error. Go look at the comments on some of my old videos for setup. DLL error just plagues you in Windows. So let's go ahead and look at what's really going on here. This is where we've installed it to. This is my base Python environment. But then I go into the Minikonda 3, and this is the base install. If you go into a directory in here called envs, that shows you the sub environments that you've created for this. And unfortunately, DLLs tend to bleed through. So even though you've created this virtual environment, it's not as pure as it is in other operating systems. What you've got to do is get completely out of this and make sure that Jupyter was started in that environment. You can't just dynamically switch environments like that, at least at this point in Windows with Anaconda. I found this to cause all sorts of errors. Just make sure that you actually start up a command prompt, Duconda, activate TensorFlow before Jupyter. Now you see from the prompt you've switched into that environment, and now you start up Jupyter Notebook. Now things will be happier. Let's open up our notebook. There's that ugly error from before. Now it'll be fixed. Because having that main environment, or that main DOS prompt that we started from, switched out to that environment, allows those DLLs to be in the path, and now they're going to be found. Pauses are good here, because that means it's working. Now that's a typo. I can't spell version. 2.0, perfect. So always make sure you do that extra step when you're dealing with Windows. Let me show you another shortcut that you can potentially do, that they do to make this a little easier. You can run Jupyter Notebook for that environment right from the command prompt. And that saves you having to activate it. That does those steps automatically for you. So now we've launched it from the start prompt. We open that same notebook, and it should work just fine. Anaconda also gives you something called an Anaconda prompt. I tend to not use that because I often put Python into the actual path, that checkbox that we saw during the install. Okay, there we are, 2.0. So either launch Jupyter from the start menu like I just showed you, or make sure to activate first. Okay, you should have an environment all set up and ready to go. If you ran into some problems, then definitely post a comment or Google to try to find your answer. Thank you for watching this video, and if you found this kind of thing interesting, please subscribe to my YouTube channel.